Hello, the internet, and welcome to another episode of
80-Bit Pod Smash,
where gaming goes to grab a beer. We are your hosts, Penguin and Termite, and we are extremely excited to have another interview episode planned for you this evening.
That's right. This episode's going to be our, as our listeners are well aware, I like to call each episode by the ship that I think best represents the episode, and this week we're going to have the aircraft carrier.
Aircraft carrier, it's about time.
The most badass of ships, and
it's
this is
amazing.
The most badass of episodes.
All right.
So without any further delay, I'll go ahead and introduce our special guest for today.
All right.
We are joined by Andrew Ray, who goes by A-Ray, and he is what I would describe as a movement artist, which if that doesn't sound badass to you listeners, I'll let him describe a little bit more. So why don't you say hi, A-Ray?
Hey, how you guys doing?
Awesome.
Yeah.
We're so excited to have you on our show tonight. We thank you for coming to join us, and we're honored to have you here. It sounds like, based on what we've looked up and what you've told us you do, motion capture, stage combat, we're extremely excited to share you with our audience, and I hope that our audience will give us good feedback and good comments and questions.
Yeah, I mean, I know A-Ray. He's joining us today because some of our listeners might not know, I at one point in my life wanted to be a fight director, and so I went to workshop three years ago and trained in stage combat, and A-Ray taught me how to do crazy things with a knife, which is the most psychotic thing that I will say today. But why don't you give us your what we call your elevator speech? Tell us a little bit kind of what you do, just in general, and a little bit about yourself.
Yeah, man. Well, I've essentially got three different careers, three different jobs. I'm a theatrical fight director. I'm a certified stage combat instructor with the Society of American Fight Directors. And then I'm also a motion capture performer, mainly focusing in video games. That's kind of the career at this point. And the mocap stuff is really taken off. I've been doing motion capture for almost 11 years now in the video game industry. So, yeah, it's hard to say it's the most fun that I have because everything that I do tends to be, I mean, I'm very lucky to have jobs where I just get to be a big kid all the time. So, but the motion capture is probably the most fun I have, I'd say.
Yeah. So you fit right in to what we do on this podcast. So we're really excited to get to interview someone who not only works in the industry, but probably, in my opinion, arguably does the coolest job in the industry. But before we get really kicking off with this interview, we do a little bit at the start of every episode called DLC, or downloadable content.
Yep.
So we're going to jump right into that. The DLC I have planned for us today is, this is a question for you, A-Ray. So if you could pick a pop culture character that if you were thrown into an arena you wanted to fight, that you think you could take but would still make for a pretty cool fight, who would you want to fight? What weapon would you use against them, and how would you approach fighting them?
Ooh.
Pop culture character, or just pop culture person in general?
It could be like a character from a video game. It could be a character from comics, movies, TV shows. Like, if you had to fight someone, and it would be like a good fight that you would want, but you also think you'd have a chance. So, I mean, if you think you have a chance against the Hulk, like, more power to you. I'd be terrified to fight the Hulk.
I'm thinking of, like, Daredevil and how hard that would be to fight.
Yeah, that'd be difficult. You know what? I'm going to go with one that's very personal to me. I think I would try and fight Johnny Gat.
Okay.
All right.
And here's the reason why. Is I've played Johnny Gat. I am Johnny Gat. So I would know everything that he would want to do or try to do. So I feel like I'd match up really well. And if you take out him, like, he's kind of a badass and he just kills people all the time. And so I feel like that'd be a kind of a loophole that I could get in and still get a little bit of shine.
Nice.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay. So
that'd
for the listeners who aren't aware, Johnny Gat is a character in the Saints Row series. Is he in all three, four?
There's four of them.
Four
games. He's in all of them. And he has his own standalone game, the Gat Out of Hell game.
He's
actually in essentially five of them.
Okay.
Wow.
So what weapon would you choose to fight him with?
I'd have to pick a knife, man. I'd have to go with a knife.
Yeah.
And how would you approach fighting him? What would you do to counter the moves that you already know he would do?
Well, he likes to fight with guns. So okay. I would have to find a way to kind of get in. I mean, he can fight with a knife too, but get in with him, make him trust me a little bit, maybe right. get in with the crew, and then a little sneak attack action with
the
knife.
Because
the knife's quick, man. Yeah, I mean, if you can get in quick with a knife, then I mean the fight's not very long.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah.
Sweet.
So yeah, that'd be how I'd go about taking out my dude.
Okay,
it would be hard to take him out though, because that's my guy.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. For sure. Sweet. Well, then
it's like
one
fighting yourself.
One final question with the DLC. Then, what is a pop culture character? Like I said, the Hulk earlier. Who's someone that you'd never want to be stuck in an arena fighting against?
Let's see. Pop culture character that I would never want to be stuck in an arena with. Now, I've got the Hulk in my head, so I don't want to say that because you've already said that. But probably Batman.
Mm. Oh, yeah, yeah.
We wouldn't want to mess with Batman. Can't sneak he's
up.
Too smart.
Can't sneak up on
no,
Batman.
He's no, like, he's and even when you think you've got him beat, like, he just doesn't quit. Like, it would be exhausting trying to fight him, I think.
Yeah.
And he's got armor, so, like, your punches are half effective. And, yeah, and if you have a knife, it doesn't do anything because his armor is knife protective, like, immune. Yeah.
I think even if I had superpowers, I wouldn't want to fight Batman or the Hulk for that matter.
Yeah.
Like, even if I were like, oh, I could give myself any power and be all powerful, like, it doesn't matter. The Hulk beats people who are more powerful than him all the time.
Yeah.
And so does Batman for that matter. So, like,
depends on what kind of superpowers you have.
Short of, like, Scarlet Witch's reality bending ability, like, I don't think there's any power in the world that would prepare me for the Hulk.
Yeah.
He's just scary, man. He just gets angry.
Yeah.
But, yeah. Cool. Awesome. Well, that's our DLC for the day. Why don't we
move
on to our interview.
All right. So you already gave us your elevator speech. So we're going to start with the beginning. How did you get into mocap?
Well, you know, it's a really kind of cool, interesting story. And people ask me all the time, how do you get into mocap? And I never have a good answer for them because I got in. I had a friend named Henry Layton, who actually was the player on Saints Row, like the person you actually control. He did the majority of that work. He was working on a game, Chronicles of Riddick, out in Sweden. He got brought in.
You know that guy? Wait.
Yeah.
That game's
so
amazing.
Game was awesome.
Nerd out.
so he kind of got pulled in to do that job and, recognized that my skill set kind of catered to what he thought motion capture performance in video games was going to be. And so when he got back to the States, he was like, hey, man, we got to put a video together for you. We got to let people know that, like, this is what you're supposed to do, I think. And he was a stage combat. He was a fight director, and I'd worked with him doing stage combat. And I think he kind of wanted to work with people that he thought were kind of up on his level because he didn't feel like he was getting quality work done because of, 10 years ago, no one wanted to do motion capture in video games. Like, it was, like, the lowest thing. So agents weren't trying to get their actors jobs. They weren't sending them out for those things, so you were getting a lot of people who were trying to break into modeling and people who had weird movement backgrounds that got thrown into motion capture. And what they really needed were actors who could perform physically very well. So we put together this video showing off everything that I could do. It was kind of a mini reel kind of audition tape, and it took probably 6 months before anybody even looked at it. And then apparently, and I've heard this story secondhand, they were doing a Saints Row shoot up in New York, and the lead animator just decided that he didn't want to deal with any of the people that he was working with anymore, and he asked to see the video, and then they called me. I was actually standing on stage at an outdoor drama called Blue Jacket with Mark Gwynn, who stage combat people know as Rat. And I get a phone call from New York, and it's this guy with a really thick accent, and he's asking me if I'm available. So I asked Rat, and he's like, yeah, go. You got an understudy, so go. And I got on a plane the next day, and I flew to New York. And it was Perspective Studios, which is now Rockstar's motion capture studio up in New York.
Wow.
It was the first time I'd ever been to New York. I get off the plane. I take a taxi cab straight to the studio because I took an early morning flight. I walk into the studio. It's this huge studio, and there's Max Payne posters on the wall and like all these video games that I played. And I walk in and they suit me up and I walk into the studio. My friends stand there and I was like, dude, I don't know what the hell I'm doing. And he was like, don't worry about it. Just do you and pay attention and take direction. And I was up there for a week doing that. And it was for Saints Row. And then Saints Row 2 started up and we started working on that. And that was almost 11 years ago. And I've been working with Volition ever since. They brought me in on every shoot they've ever done. And then I've started to branch out to other studios now and work on other stuff.
What are some of the other studios that you work with?
Right now, I've been doing a lot. Well, I've been doing a lot of work with Gearbox.
Wait,
they're actually like 3 hours down the road from where I live.
You probably have non-disclosure agreements, but I'm guessing
I do.
Yes. <All right>.
Nope. It's
unbelievable.
It's cool.
All right,
it's cool.
We can speculate what you're working on.
We'll speculate what you're working on.
All right.
I can talk about one of the games that I'm working on with them, but that's it. But I've been doing a little bit of work on We Happy Few, which comes out in April.
I can't say anything about it.
I can tell you that I did the announcement trailer that came out in August where the guy's getting chased down the street and they shove the pills. So I did all those characters in that trailer and then did some stuff in game. Most of the stuff in game they don't use motion capture for. It's a lot of hand keyed stuff. But met the writer of that game and some of the people working on it. And it's going to be really cool, I think. I mean, just the concept behind the whole game is really kind of awesome. And the art direction that they did was kind of great.
Awesome.
But how I got into mocap, you know, it was like got a chance because a friend recommended me and I kind of took advantage of the chance and made sure that I didn't give them a reason to not call me again.
Good work, man. That's amazing.
Yeah.
It's a really cool story, man. And it's one of those moments too where you go from being a struggling actor to an actor who can make a living overnight. It was like financially it was a completely different, you know, my parents stopped asking me whether I wanted to go into advertising and all this other stuff, you know, and it was like they knew I was going to be fine and I knew I was going to be all right. And it gave me a lot of freedom to do some other work. It's been great.
Well, speaking of acting and theatrical pursuits, a lot of our audience might not be, or listeners might not be familiar with what stage combat is. So why don't you kind of tell us all about that and specifically with your background? If you don't mind, give us a short
version. Stage combat, you know, there's a lot of, I guess there's a lot of different definitions. People have their own definition. My definition of stage combat is the art of portraying violence on stage in a safe way.
Mm-hmm.
And I consider stage combat an advanced acting technique. I teach it as an acting technique. A lot of people just think it's stunts or martial arts, and there's so much more involved. But I could do a 3-hour podcast on stage combat alone. So
we might have you on that.
I won't get too far down that rabbit hole. But stage combat. Anytime you see people, you know, fighting in movies with weapons or fighting on stage, even so far as like just people falling down, and you watch people who do physical comedy and fall down multiple times without actually hurting themselves, all that stuff is considered stage combat. And so I'm a certified stage combat instructor with an organization called the Society of American Fight Directors, which is the governing body of stage combat within the United States. There's other organizations, but that's the biggest and kind of the most well known. And there's only, I think there's 112 certified teachers in the SAFD.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm one of those, which is cool. I love stage combat. I love teaching it and choreographing fights and kind of creating those types of stories. I tend to tell people I like to use the best of people to show scenes that portray the worst of people.
Because
stage combat is about communication and partnering and trust and all this wonderful stuff. And then we use that to show like just horrific, violent scenes and tell very violent, horrible stories. That's stage combat.
Yeah, one of the other instructors, one of the fight masters at the workshop that I went to, he sold these shirts, and I actually bought one, and they have, it's Dale Gerard, and and he sells a shirt that says, teaching compassion, friendship, cooperation, loyalty through violence, or something like that, and it's great. It's one of my favorites.
Is that the Dale Kwon Do? Is that the Dale Kwon Do t-shirt?
Yeah.
His studio is called Dale Kwon Do.
Whenever I put that shirt on, I'm like, I love this shirt. And people will come up to me, like, I'll be standing in line at the bank or something, and they'll be like, I love that shirt. That's amazing. That's fun. When did you get into stage combat? Like, when did you decide that was something that you wanted to do the rest of your life?
It was right about, you know, I went to school at University of Kentucky. I got my undergraduate degree there as a theater major, and I was a musical theater kid like most people who go into theater. Grow up doing, you know, I was in Grease and the Pajama Gang. Mm-hmm. I went to high school with a girl named Laura Bell Bundy, who is a Tony-nominated actress.
Wow.
Elle Woods on Broadway. Like, we went to high school together and grew up together, and I went to an art school. And so I thought I was going to be a musical theater kid and sing and dance and all that stuff. which was the idea until, and I was also an athlete growing up. And so when my acting teacher found out that I was an athlete, she cast me in a production of Robin Hood when I was like 20 years old.
Nice.
And a fight director walked up and put a broadsword in my hand. And it was just, it's one of those moments where like, they put a broadsword in my hand, it just clicks, yep. And you're like, oh, wait, okay, this is what I'm going to do forever now.
Yep.
And it was one of those things that, you know, I picked it up. I had the skill set to pick it up really quickly. Mm-hmm. And so I got kind of progressed through the organization quicker and got kind of put on the front burner of somebody who, like, this kid needs to get jobs. And I kind of got moved around a whole lot through certain theaters and ended up meeting my teacher, Mark Gwynn, and going to grad school at Louisiana Tech with him and just kind of really focusing in on that type of work as a career path.
That's awesome.
And then Stage Combat ended up opening up motion capture to me because the people who got me into mocap were Stage Combat people. So it was kind of worked together.
And all that student loan debt, if you had any, finally paid off. This is awesome.
Yeah. Luckily I didn't have too much. My grandfather looked out for me and put a bunch of money away. So undergrad was paid for, had a little bit of student loan from debt from grad school, but not very much. So I'm very lucky. Some of my friends aren't so lucky and they have like crazy amounts of student loan debt.
Yep. Yeah, that's my wife.
Mm. It sucks.
It sounds like you're pretty interested in gaming. Like you said, you walked into that studio and you saw some Max Payne posters up on the wall, and you were kind of excited. So, can you tell our audience and ourselves, like, what's your gaming background, and were you a gamer before you did mocap? Or,
yeah, I mean, I got a not to date myself, but I got a Nintendo Entertainment System, I think, for Christmas when I was like 6 years old.
Awesome,
like the year that it came out. And started, you know, gaming as a kid. And I pretty much had probably every system that has come out I've had at some point. I mean, I was just, when you guys called me, I was playing the new South Park game.
Yeah, he's playing it right now.
Yeah, we're both playing it right now.
It's so good, man. It's so much fun.
Yeah, it's hilarious.
I've been a gamer. And you know, you go through kind of, I go through kind of waves and phases of like, sometimes I'll just play sports games. And then sometimes I'll get into certain RPGs and I'll play. And I've played pretty much anything, any type of genre of game I've been into at some point. And then sometimes because of the work schedule and the travel schedule, I get backlogged on games. Sure. And I've got like a stack of games that I need to play. And so when I get a little bit of time off, that's all I do.
I don't know if you have a Nintendo Switch or not, but
I don't yet. I want one.
It certainly would fit in with the travel lifestyle. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you have to.
Yeah. Well, I have a PlayStation 4 backpack that I put my PS4 in. I take it if I'm not flying, and I'm longer than a week. Like I've got that.
That's awesome.
Me.
Good deal.
I got married about 2.5 years ago, so I got to kind of pick and choose what I get now. Mm-hmm. You know, you gotta the finances are linked at this point.
Yes.
So.
Yep. And time too, not just money.
Yep.
Yeah.
Awesome.
True.
Yeah. What is your favorite game then? If you could pick an overall, and maybe you can do it. Maybe you can do a top three. If you can't pick one, then you can give me three.
Top three. I'll preface by saying, I think Zelda: Ocarina of Time is the greatest video game ever made. More reasons than just like, oh, how awesome it was. But I think at the time.
Yep.
The things that did and the way the story was told, this kind of nonlinear, this ability to kind of go everywhere. It wasn't the first game that did that, mm-hmm. but it was the first game that like everyone I knew had mm-hmm. it that did that. So that would be on the list. I mean, Uncharted is just a franchise.
Yes.
Like, I love those games so much. I actually know the guys who make those games, and they're incredible. And when you meet them, like, you totally understand why those games are the way they are, because those guys are so detail oriented and meticulous. And it's just like Naughty Dog's got this like family atmosphere, like when they shoot. And so you see that come through in the games. Uncharted. And
I don't want to interrupt your thoughts here, but do you know Amy Hennig or Neil Druckmann? Like,
I don't.
They're the writers.
I know.
But... Who the
I don't know the right. I was at GDC last year and met a couple of the animators and got to have dinner with a bunch of animators from a bunch of different companies. And those, the two lead animators for Uncharted were there, and I was kind of like star. It was the only time I was like starstruck because one of the dudes, the lead animator, I can't remember his name. I totally blanked on his name. Is actually like kind of Nathan Drake.
Nice.
Like the way he looks and the way he's built. Like, they obviously kind of modeled the style of the character after him.
Okay.
And so he like walks in the room and everybody like turns and looks and he's like this really nice looking dude.
Yeah.
And I'm like, dude, he's like a blonde haired version of Nathan Drake. but they were like super, super cool, down to earth, like just really love what they do and love telling those types of stories. And he was talking about we want to make games that are like people are playing Hollywood summer blockbuster movies. Like that's what they are trying to do with those games.
And they've nailed
it. Totally
that.
Plays like that.
Yeah,
it's great. And I have so much fun. It's a game that like my wife will sit there and watch me play those games because they're so kind of the story's so good and they're so beautifully put together. So yeah, Uncharted would be there. And then I'd have to go. I'm a big basketball fan, so I love NBA 2K.
Okay.
Like, I love the 2K series. I love what they do. I play that game probably more than anything.
Okay.
Because I'm a big sports fan, a big basketball fan.
Sweet.
Is that one of the games?
So those would be my three.
That's got the loot boxes.
Oh, yeah, that was the play.
How do you feel about the loot boxes in the new one?
You know, I haven't gotten the new one yet. Okay. I've got last year's version, and I just haven't gotten around to buying the new one. I don't like the idea of annual sports games. I think it's kind of lame.
Okay.
Yep. And I know for a fact that those guys could just put out a patch to update the game, and they don't because people buy like millions of copies every year. And it's like, well, why wouldn't you?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Madden's on the top selling list like every single month. Like, it's ridiculous.
It yeah, and it's like, time. Man, stop buying that game. Just play the old game.
Just patch
and
it.
I don't. I'm not a huge Madden fan. I played football, and should be a Madden fan, but I don't know. I get bored with Madden really easily. Mm-hmm. Well, with 2K, it's, I don't know, basketball is a much more fast-paced, it's a much more fun game to play, in my opinion. So, yeah.
Sweet. Awesome. All right, we can move on to, one more favorite question. What's the favorite game that you've worked on? So, of the games that you've worked on, what's your favorite?
You know, that's a really hard question. I really loved working on Gat Out of Hell,
okay,
the Saints Row kind of spinoff for Johnny Gat. But I'll tell you, Agents of Mayhem is probably the most rewarding experience I've ever had because I played every single male character on the game.
Wow.
And so it forced me to really figure out. It's like with motion capture performance, like nobody teaches you how to do this. Like there's nobody teaching this at universities.
Sure.
And if they are, it's probably a very dated version because motion capture has to keep up with technology and technology moves like it faster than anything.
Mm-hmm.
And so I had to develop a technique to be able to play multiple characters, I mean, from 1 minute to the next in the studio and figure out why people move the way they move and how moving in a video game world is different than moving on a stage or on a film set.
Mm.
So Agents of Mayhem is probably the most rewarding thing I've ever done, but the Saints Row games are just so much fun to work on, man. You just like you laugh, like I'll go home and my chest will hurt from just laughing on set. Cause we have so much fun, man. And the Volition guys are so cool.
That's awesome. Awesome. Cool. All right. What would you say influences your work? Like, where do you, from what wells do you draw inspiration?
Well, you know, pop culture, because a lot of video games, like a lot of times when you walk in the studio and they're telling you a character, they'll give you some sort of pop culture reference.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
They'll say things like, oh, he's The Rock if The Rock had a big belly or something like that. I mean, that was literally the direction for Hardtack on Agents of Mayhem, the big sailor character.
Okay.
They're like, it's like The Rock was big and a sailor, but kind of has that attitude. And it's like, okay. So now I have like, so I'll go watch videos of like who those are. Music is a big one too, because in video games, it seems like people are kind of moving to a soundtrack. It's like in a movie.
Yeah. Oh.
It's like this kind of over romanticized version of like how we picture ourselves when we like, you know, those movie moments where like the doors open and someone walks into like the perfect song.
Yeah.
Video game characters kind of move that way. So I would think about what type of music represented each individual character. And so when you're doing a walk, like you're walking to that type of music. And then just people watching in general, like I'll go to the mall and I'll kind of walk around and just look at people's feet and how different foot placement affects a center of gravity in the body and how people walk and why based on like how big they are. So I could play a character that's three times my size because I've watched bigger people move around. It's like, okay, that's how they carry their weight. Because what you're really doing in motion capture is you're puppeteering a rig. You're puppeteering a character in a digital space.
Wow.
So that's most of the stuff that kind of caters. And then all my basic acting techniques from that you learn in school, that stuff never leaves either. It's always a part of what you're doing.
Awesome. Cool.
Yeah.
So what does an average day in the studio look like? Like walk us through the morning. You're just showing up for work. you know, midway through production of some game, or what does that look like for you?
Yeah, I mean, I mean, you show up and they have breakfast, which is sweet, catered breakfast. So you get a little bit of food. You can't eat too much food because you wear spandex all day long, and you don't want to be that guy with the belly bulging out of your spandex. Yeah, no food babies. Plus, you know, it gets pretty strenuous sometimes. A lot of times you don't know. You may get a shot list like the day before. So a lot of times you're kind of reacting on the fly to stuff. Then you get suited up. They put all the markers on you. They got all these, production assistants in there putting markers on you and your gloves and your hat. And then you go in, you do what's called a ROM, which you do this thing called a T-pose where you stand with your arms straight out and your feet straight. And they check and make sure all the markers are there. And they just capture kind of range of motion of your movement. And then you just kind of go through the shot list. And some of it will be in-game and some of it will be cinematic. Typically, they're bunched together. So you do, like, in the morning, you may do some in-game stuff. There's a bunch of different characters, like walks and runs and attacks, melee attacks and pulling guns and different weapons and stuff. And then some, like, pedestrian reactions or enemy reactions getting shot. And then you'll go do cinematics, like, in the afternoon, and you'll have, four or five actors in the space. And you're just essentially just performing the scene with the cameras being everywhere. So it's kind of a hybrid of theater and film.
All right.
Oh, and then awesome. Yeah, you wrap at the end of the day and go to dinner and hang out and talk
to the
people from the studio. And it's pretty fun, man.
I remember when you did a little workshop on mocap the 3 weeks that I was there. And I do remember doing the T-poses, and that was just, it was so much fun doing.
Yeah, I had there were 40 or 50 of you guys in that class. It was like everybody. It was
too
so
many
hard.
People.
They were like, oh, here's every student at the workshop. Do your mocap workshop in an hour and a half. And me, I'm like super nerdy about it. And I'm like, but there's not enough time to like dive into the finer details. So you just get these awful broad strokes sometimes because there's just so many people.
I could tell you though, even those broad strokes, it was like, oh, I'm so inspired. I want to do this.
Yeah.
So, that's good. Cool. What are some challenges that you find comes with mocap work?
Well, I mean, most people don't know how to do it, and it's not their fault. They've got talent. They just don't know how to apply it to this type of work.
Mm-hmm.
So when you walk into a studio and you see someone that you know has been doing mocap, you're just like, it's such a blessing to have like experienced motion capture performers. I'm very lucky to work with a group out in Los Angeles quite a bit that are like super talented people who've worked on everything. People like Maggie McDonald, who works on Last of Us, and people like Tomiko Brownlee, who did Halo and all sorts of like all these different games.
Wow.
So sometimes you get in there and the person's like, I've never done mocap before. And you're just like, oh, and you're kind of helping them and teaching them as they go, and which is fine. Most people just need a little bit of guidance. Mm. But a lot of times it's not the actor's place to give that guidance.
Mm.
But I work with a good group of guys, and a lot of times they'll be like, go talk to A-Ray. He's been doing this for a while, and actors will come up and ask me questions, which is cool. The other difficult thing about it is sometimes the game developers don't understand that the thing they saw in the movie is sometimes affected by digital effects and by wire work and some of these things that they don't. And so they'll come in and they'll show us something from a movie and they'll say, we want you to do that. And you'll go, well, I'm going to need the wires that guy used when he shot that to be able to make it look like that, but I'll do it. And a lot of times it's just because they don't realize that like they got tricked by the movie.
Yeah.
And you can't jump with 2 feet, double leg drop kick and land standing on my chest in real life because I will die. So sometimes you have to have, and it's delicate conversations because they're very passionate about what they want. And I'm there to give them what they want within my ability.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's just not within my ability. So you just have to tell them like, hey man, I can't do backflips. So don't ask me to do backflips. Like it's not what I do.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Cool. Speaking of doing things that you might not be able to do or unsure if you're able to do, what would you describe as the craziest stunt that you've ever done while doing motion capture work? And what game was it for?
Saints Row had a lot of crazy stunts. I did a high fall. We had to do this high fall where I was laying on my back on top of scaffolding, and they had put straps, they had Velcroed straps to me, and had a gaiter back on. So what had to happen was the guy who was working with me was holding onto the straps, and he had to lift me up and bounce me off the top of the scaffolding and lift me so that my hips went over the edge of the scaffolding. And then I just did a fall, you know, reached out, tried to touch my toes and land on my back. And we had these, like, we used to have these, like, boots that covered our shoes, and they were slick on the bottom. So he bounced me off the scaffolding and slipped and fell. And he just dove off the scaffolding and did like a flip onto the pad. And I came down and my hips hit the edge of the scaffolding and I rotated and fell head first and just put my arms out to try and break my fall and landed between two mats. And it was probably 20 feet. And I thought I was going to break my neck. I got very lucky in the way I hit and where I hit on the mat. And everybody was great. They all freaked out. They ran over to me and made sure I was okay. And, you know, you have that moment anytime, you know, with stunts, like there's just some danger involved.
Oh, sure.
And we're always kind of pushing the envelope a little bit of what we should probably be doing. And, you know, you have union guys who are like, yeah, you can't do that or you can't do this. Or, but, you know, there's moments where you hit and you're like, I might be messed up. And then you kind of lay there and you make sure everything moves. And you're like, okay, I think I'm going to be sore tomorrow, but I think I'm okay. I've gotten to the point in my career where I don't have to do too many stunts anymore because I've kind of established myself as more of a physical character actor.
Okay.
But there's still some moments where it's like, hey, jump off that 15-foot scaffolding onto this 3-inch thick mat. And it's like, oh, okay, my hips are going to be really sore tomorrow, but all right. And you just, you figure out how to use your body and you figure out what your limitations are. And, you know, I'm a firm believer in if I don't feel comfortable doing it, I'm just going to tell people, like, I can't do it. Mm-hmm. And that's all right.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Cool. This is fascinating. What game was that for?
I think it was Saints Row, right?
It was Saints Row 2.
Okay.
So at the end of Saints Row 2, when the player fights Mero and he choke slams him and they fall through the building, it's like one of the last cutscenes. It was the fall through the building we did in like three different shots. And at one point, I'm playing Mero, I hit on a pipe. Ooh. And I had to like bounce off a pipe and roll. Okay. Mm-hmm. So that's what they were trying to get.
Gotcha. Wow. Actually, it's a good segue into my next question. Was there's three or four Saints Row titles, plus you said the offshoot. Of those, what did you work on?
The very, very end of one, and then 2, 3, 4, and Get Out of Hell.
So you kind of...
So like... everything, pretty much everything, but not very much in one. I think it was like one pickup shoot, and then because they immediately started Saints Row 2. Like, as soon as Saints Row 1 was over, they started Saints Row 2 right away. Like, it had already been greenlit.
Wow, nice. All right. And what was it like to work with the Volition Group? They're the studio that developed the game, right?
They're the best, man. Some of those guys were at my wedding. Like, they're that company. I love the guys who work at that company, and they get new guys in, and they fit right in. And it's just like some of my really, really close friends are guys and girls who have worked there and have moved on, and guys who still work there. Like, really, really great people.
Awesome.
I've never had an issue with everybody I've worked with from Volition's been awesome, and they love what they do, and they're passionate about just making games that they think are going to be fun.
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of their approach to everything. It's like, well, we think it's funny and we think it's awesome.
Kicked over a bottle.
Nice. So I don't know if this affects you or if you're in this world, but I'm curious to know, Saints Row 1 through 3, they were published by THQ, and then Deep Silver picked up the fourth one. Did this change anything for you, or like, what did the publisher's involvement look like from your perspective with that?
It didn't really change anything for me. I mean, we used to get really expensive dinners paid for when THQ was was just like, they were just handing out credit cards and people were just spending money. Like, there was a moment where we were at Yamashiro in LA, and THQ paid for the whole meal, and it had to be, I mean, there were 15 of us there. And that place is expensive. It had to have been a couple $1,000s for dinner. Wow. And they just put it on a THQ corporate card. And I was like,
unbelievable.
Aren't y'all having money problems? And this is like during Saints Row the Third.
Like, yeah. Like, maybe that's why THQ is not with us anymore.
Oh, yeah. Everybody kind of saw the writing on the wall and was like, let's spend this money while we got it. As an actor, like, nothing really changed for me. I was still working with the same people, doing the same stuff.
Okay.
I do know that. From what I've heard, and this is all secondhand through people, THQ kind of let Volition kind of do what they do.
Oh, good.
And Deep Silver it's more of kind of a partnership where Deep Silver approves things for Volition to do. And so I think sometimes it takes a little bit longer because Deep Silver is actually owned by a company called Koch Media, which is a German conglomerate, entertainment conglomerate.
Oh, I know.
And
that.
They actually have the say. So Deep Silver has to kind of go to them and then get back to Volition. And so it's this kind of chain that I think slows things down on Volition's end. But I mean, by the time I'm in the studio, everything's been approved and we're just working.
So yeah, it sounds like you're pretty isolated from all of the publisher politics nonsense that happens. Yeah, is that would you say that's true?
Okay. I'm glad too. I'm glad I don't have to deal with any of that stuff because it seems sometimes like a headache.
Yeah, it's easy for our perspective as consumers and our audience as well to think that like the publishers are the big evil, you know, money penny pinchers and you know money bags counters and bean counters trying to stifle the developers, you know, drive and vision and passion for game creation. But you just mentioned that Deep Silver answers to a greater entity as well. And so like everything kind of hands up, and I'm glad that you don't have to deal with that as a motion cap artist, but it also kind of sheds some light to our audience that publishers are also driven by the things that they need to as well. And it kind of like levels the playing field.
Yeah.
They're not these big, bad, you know, bean counters and trying to, you know, stifle creativity. It sounds like they're all trying to make money while doing something they're passionate about at the same time.
Yeah, I wonder how much the isolation, though, affects their perspective, because it does sound like you don't ever get to talk to a publisher, so no one comes in.
I mean, Gearbox is publishing, Gearbox is the publisher for We Happy Few.
Mm-hmm.
So they're publishing the game for Compulsion. And so when I work with them, like I'm actually working for the publisher when I go in there and do stuff, because Gearbox does everything in house.
Okay.
And so, and they're great. And I think sometimes, you know, like as an artist, like I kind of understand, because I've worked in theater, sometimes the artist has to be reined in and told like, okay, you can play, but you got to play within these parameters.
Yeah.
We can't just let you, I mean, if we just let you spend and go and do whatever, like you see what happened to THQ. And I'm not saying that that was because of developers. That had more to do with money at the top and some other investments and things that they invested in that kind of fell through that didn't have anything to do with their development companies. But yeah, I think, you know, publishers seem to, I mean, somebody's got to understand bottom line at some point.
Mm-hmm.
Because if they let us creatives just go crazy, we'll just create and create. And nobody will ever make a living. You know what I mean? but I am very isolated from it. Yeah, it's just not. That's way above my pay grade to worry about anything like that.
You just come in, you know, move around, get paid.
Yeah, come in, do my job, and try and be as financially efficient for them as I possibly can.
Cool.
Because they keep bringing me back.
Yeah, nice. Yeah. So, to maybe take a more serious tone for our interview, back in late September, Volition was hit with a bunch of layoffs following the release of Agents of Mayhem, and you worked on Agents of Mayhem, so did this have any impact on you or your future work?
I mean, it kind of did. It didn't with the company, because I'm still going to work with Volition on whatever they do. I don't know if Agents of Mayhem will move. I know that their big plan for Agents of Mayhem was kind of awesome, and it was going to be this huge, not even collection of games. It was going to just continue to build over time.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if that'll be a thing that'll happen now, because it didn't sell quite what they expected, what the publishers expected it to do. And I think, you know, I played the game, and granted, you know, I kind of look at it through rose colored glasses because it was such a wonderful experience as a performer to work on. But I think the biggest problem with Agents of Mayhem is it followed Saints Row.
Yeah.
And there was this kind of blurred line as to whether it was or it wasn't a Saints Row game. And I don't think any of the companies really decided a firm line of whether it was or wasn't. And I kind of understand both sides. Publisher buys a company and they have a title like Saints Row. And then the development company says, oh, well, yeah, but we're not going to make a Saints Row game. The publisher's like, no, we spent money on you because you make Saints Row. So we're going to do something. So I think there was some kind of back and forth on that. Again, I don't really know any of the particulars. It didn't really affect me. It affected some of my friends. Some of my friends got let go. Most of the people that I know that are like kind of the people I've been working with for a really long time are all still there. But I had some friends who were animators who got let go, and they're good. They'll land on their feet somewhere else. That's kind of how the video game industry works. You hire in a bunch of people. Once the game releases, people get let go because they don't need them during the development process. And then once you get into really making the game, they'll hire a bunch of new people. So a lot of these guys and girls end up at different companies. Like, if you look at their resumes, they're just constantly at different companies working on different projects.
That's nice. Good. I'm glad to hear that, like, these companies and the shifting that happens around at the high level in layoffs that happen affects personal lives, like individuals with families and kids. And that's their income and their livelihood. So it's good to hear that a lot of these people do land on their feet and they do find more work. Because every time I read these articles about these big giant layoffs and the stuff that studios that get shut down, I'm like, man, that's just so many lives affected and maybe kids affected. Yeah. And I kind of like have this compassion for them, but I'm glad to hear that Volition seems to be doing all right despite that.
Yeah. I mean, I had a friend who got laid off and he just got full custody of his daughter, who's like, I think she's like 10 or 11. And got her moved up to Champaign and got her in school and all this stuff. And then he got laid off and he's looking for work. And, you know, he'll find work. He's extremely talented, but it's like having to move your kid again and having to, you know, as an actor, like I know very little people in my industry who get fired. Mm-hmm. Like, it just doesn't happen. Like, you get hired in on a gig, and even if you're not good, they finish out your contract and then your contract's over and you move on to another gig. And so when I have friends call me and go, hey, I'm not with the company anymore, they laid me off, they let me go, like, I never know how to really handle it because I've never had to. And I just, it made me realize, like, oh wow, man, having to go in and tell your kids, like, hey, we're leaving all your friends and we're leaving all this stuff that you know, because this is the only company in this city, so we got to move to another city. And, you know, people end up, you know, having good lives wherever they go. Kids get into school and they make friends and stuff like that. But it's got to be tough.
Yeah, yeah.
For sure.
Absolutely. So you kind of touched on this at the very beginning of our interview, but do you have any more motion capture work lined up in the video game industry in the future?
Yeah, I do. I mean, I'm working on a few games right now. Most of the stuff I can't talk about,
sure,
you know,
because
of non-disclosure. But yeah, man, I mean, there's a shelf life for a motion capture actor. Like, I know that as I get older, my physical skills will diminish and I won't be able to do as much. That's why I've already started transitioning out of stunts and, you know, being the fighter guy to being like more of a character actor, physical character actor, because I'll be able to do that longer. I'm trying to kind of transition into more directing and teaching younger people how to do this good, so that it continues to be a viable art form for actors to be able to make a living at. But I've got gigs lined up, and more of them will come. I got more games that I know that I'm a part of. You know, you go through these kind of pockets of time where, like, there isn't anything to capture yet.
Yeah, yeah.
They're writing scripts and they're, you know, putting together animatics and figuring out what their cutscenes are going to look like, and character development and character artwork and stuff like that. And then they'll call me up and go, hey, we're going to start shooting. And once you start shooting, it's like, you know, every month you're flying out to LA to do something, or going to Dallas or Chicago or something like that. So it kind of comes in waves. And then in between time, I'm doing all sorts of theater work and teaching. So I stay pretty busy. I've been home like 2 weeks since Christmas.
Wow.
So I'm on the road all the time.
Yeah,
I've actually got this week, I just got back from Dallas, and I've got like 5 days before I have to go back. So I have like 5 days to kind of hang out with my wife and and play South Park and watch basketball. So
awesome.
Yeah.
Well, that makes me even more honored to have you as a guest on our show here. Thank you so much for
some time.
Giving us the hour or so that you've given us.
Mm-hmm.
No problem, man.
What do you think? I don't think this question was included, but it just kind of came to mind. Mm-hmm. What do you think the future of the industry looks like as technology develops?
Well, I know that they're going to get to use less actors. We're already using less actors. When I first started, you'd have 10 to 12 people in the studio, and we did Agents of Mayhem, which had 15, I think 15 playable characters at launch, with the idea of putting out more and more that we had already captured and developed. I think I played 32 different characters.
Wow.
If you include like all of the enemies, the villains and stuff that I've played too. And then I did that with pretty much two female actresses who played all the girls. And then we had like a couple of stunt actors who came in to do very specific things. But I think there's 5 mocap actors on that game, and every character has an individual animation, where like nothing was stock. Like, we didn't do any stock animation for any of those characters. It's all the walk, the idol, all the weapons, the way they fight, everything was individual for each character. So we did a lot of work, but it was just a few of us. And like, even with Get Out of Hell, like there were two, it was me and a mocap actor named America Young, who played Kenzie in the Saints Row games.
Okay.
We played every character on Get Out of Hell except for one cutscene at the beginning. Wow. And everything else, I'm Satan, I'm all the demons, she's Kinsey and Jezebel, and any other female characters. And so yeah, it was like, that's one thing, it's going to get really condensed to where like you're gonna have to be really good at it to be able to get into it. Which is kind of a double-edged sword. It's like, how do you get good at something if you're not in? And the other thing we were talking about the other day with VO, how much VO's happening in the industry. I have this dream of like being able to put on a VO helmet in the mocap studio and look at the other actor and actually see the character.
Yeah.
And be able to interact with the character and see, you know, the whole digital world, because they just dropped the world into the studio, and I can't see it, but on the computer you can see, oh, here's a wall and there's a door and all this stuff. And to be able to actually look and see it through my eyes would be kind of awesome.
Oh, you're making the hand motions. Sorry, for our audio listeners, we can't see you. VO is virtual reality. Is that like you were
yes.
mimicking the headset?
Not VO, VR, sorry.
Yeah, okay.
I said VO, VR. So yeah, virtual reality.
I see. So you would have like a headset on and you would see your other actors around you and the world that you're in.
Yeah,
rendered,
but the other actors would be, yeah, they, it would be the rig, it would be the character rig, as opposed to, now that's just my little dream, but when I was talking to some of the guys at Gearbox about VR, it was like, they were like, oh yeah, that would be totally possible. And I was like, okay, they're way smarter than me, so if it's totally possible on their end, I don't see why it wouldn't be something that somebody would use eventually, especially if you could rig that up to be a facial capture. Where you could do facial capture and see,
oh,
it would
man.
Be
yeah,
kind of
like a
yeah,
mask
imagine,
over your face.
I imagine, especially when it comes to like fighting, like if you're doing motion capture work where you as a character are fighting like some creature that's not human.
Yeah,
like, being able to see that and see like where it is like could only make the games better looking from a
acting
perspective.
Yeah.
Instead of just trying to imagine, there's this tentacle over here that you have to block, and like here's this, you can grab this being's tail that doesn't really exist, and you know, I can see that would be very helpful to have a VR headset where you could see all that stuff played out,
and that could benefit
developers. It'd be pretty cool,
because the developers would have more to work with or the animators would have more to work with when it comes to the actual specificity of the movement.
Yeah,
but.
So you touched on something. This is another off the record like question. You talked about like Agents of Mayhem being a platform that they would add characters on as the game progressed. It seems like this whole like games as a service mentality is growing in the video game industry. So we have games like Destiny and even Nintendo kind of jumped on it with Splatoon, where you have like in-game events that change kind of the game over the course of time, and they're trying to extend the legs of the game over years, where you just like you're devoted to this one game. MMOs started it years ago, like World of Warcraft and such. So you said that Agents of Mayhem was kind of planned to be that way, like a games as a service.
Yeah, well, the way it was described to me was Saints Row meets G.I. Joe, and so the idea behind it was this collection of very specific over-the-top characters who were some sort of organization that fought against another organization. And you would have missions that took place in a certain country, and then there would be another country that would be added, and there would be a whole nother group of characters that you could add to your... So at the end, and my initial question when they started telling me about the game in the beginning was like, are y'all going to sell action figures?
Nice.
I thought that was the most logical choice, is like sell the action figures and that you can scan into the game. And so instead of buying the character as a digital download, you buy the action. I mean, just like you do with like Disney Infinite or any of those games for like kids. But like what nerds like wouldn't like, we would all want the action figures.
Yeah.
Like, I have boxes of action figures, like superhero action figures. It's like, I have this. Johnny Gat statue
oh, nice.
That
That's
they
awesome.
Gave me.
Yeah.
And it sits next to my bed, and it's, like, my favorite thing in the world. Like, if I could have action figures of all the characters that I played.
Yeah, the popularity of, like, Amiibos.
Yeah.
Nintendo's killing it.
Yeah, yeah. Although, of course, scarcity is their problem. Yeah. It would be the worst thing in the world if, like, the only way to get the character was to buy a really rare figurine.
Oh, right. That's the consequence of that,
That would be my only, like, worry about that. But so maybe, like, a digital copy alongside. Like, if you purchase the... You can either purchase it digitally or you can purchase the figure and have a cool toy to play with.
That would be sweet.
Yeah. And just look at
it. I always thought that would be a cool idea, but awesome. I'm just an actor, so
what do I know? We're just podcasters.
But no, I think that was the plan. And guys, I don't know if that's still not the plan. Like, I don't know what they're doing with Agents of Mayhem.
Okay.
I played the game. I thought the game was pretty fun. I thought a lot of the bad... Like, I understood some of the... negative criticism, but I didn't think it was at the point where, like, there were people who were just trashing it like crazy, and I was like, just trashing it because it's not, like, you're saying things like, well, it's not as funny as Saints Row, and it's like, well, it's not Saints Row.
Right.
It's not supposed to be as funny as Saints Row. You know, it has its issues, but, like, how many perfect classic video games come out in a calendar year?
Yeah.
I mean, we're lucky if we get one. Like, for every Uncharted 4 that comes out, you get 30 or 40 games that are good but not great, and I think it's kind of in that category for me of, like, it's a good game. Like, you can sit down and play it and shoot a bunch of stuff and, you know, play different characters, and I liked it, but I'm biased, so.
we'll have to rent it or something.
Yeah, we'll check
give
it out.
A good review. Yeah,
sure.
Or whatever. I haven't had a chance to play it yet, so
it sounded like it came out in August this past summer, I believe. And it sounded like it just came out in a cloud of, like, it's about, I don't know how to say this, but it almost was sent out in a bad time of year around other games that were louder, and Destiny right on the cusp of it, too.
Oh, yeah. Destiny came out right after that, and then you have all the sports games that drop.
Yep.
Yeah.
Madden 2K and FIFA, they all come out right there at the same time, and then there was some other stuff. I mean, it was right after... What came out right before? Something big came out right before it, too. I can't remember. But, yeah, it was kind of in a weird window. And it was just – it was never going to be Saints Row. Like, it's a new franchise. So, like, thinking that it's going to sell like Saints Row is a pipe dream. Like, if you wanted it to sell like Saints Row, you should have put out Saints Row.
Yeah, for sure.
There's that.
Cool. Well, cool. I think that's our show. That's our time for the day.
Yeah, we're wrapped up.
How can our listeners – find you or see your work if they are interested in checking out your work?
They can find me on Instagram. I'm on Instagram. I post a lot of stuff on there. It's a-ray-002, and then on Twitter, ADR612.
Okay.
At ADR612, on Twitter. And all that stuff's linked, so they can find me either way.
Great, awesome. And as always, guys, let us know your feedback, those who are listening. Tell us what you think you want to hear more of, if you want A-Ray to come back, and we can do a follow-up episode if you have questions.
Non-disclosure agreements.
Yeah, when those undisclosed games that we're all very excited about come out, and we can talk about them. Otherwise, if there's anything that you want clarification on, we'll try to reach out to him and put it in a future episode. And otherwise, you can get a hold of us at our Gmail, 80bitpodsmash@gmail.com. You can find us on Facebook, Twitter, the whole nine yards.
Our Twitter tag is at 80bitpodsmash. On Reddit, where we have a subreddit, 80bitpodsmash. You can find us on YouTube, also 80bitpodsmash.
80bitpodsmash.com. Yeah, all that. Just Google it, and
you'll find it. Subscribe, like, share, and follow us all.
We're a baby, but we have cool people on our interviews.
Absolutely.
Follow us.
Yep.
But great. Well, thanks again, A-Ray.